Grace to you and peace from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Sometimes I wonder what Peter, James, and John thought they were going to do that day when Jesus tapped them on the shoulder and told them to come along with him. Did they think he just wanted to go for a walk? That they were going to go heal somebody maybe? That Jesus just had to get a break from the other 9 disciples? I really wonder. If Peter had said, "Where are we going?" would Jesus have said, "We're hiking up the mountain so you can see Moses and Elijah and see me glow like the sun again"? This has to be one of those events that can never be truly explained or truly understood by people who weren't fortunate enough to be there. So this week I've just kept wondering, what is the point of the Transfiguration? Jesus already knows he was God's son and that God loved him. And at the end of the story, he tells the 3 disciples to zip it about what they'd seen. What? They'd just seen this amazing thing, and now they have to keep it quiet? They had to wonder why. If the Transfiguration wasn't for Jesus' sake, and if it wasn't for the disciples to tell others as further evidence of how special Jesus was, then what was the point of it? Let's go to the hospital. I'll never forget those words spoken by my home pastor during the summer I worked at my home church when I was about 21. I was hired that summer to do mostly youth ministry, but my pastor knew that I was supposed to be a pastor, which I was trying not to know, so he often had me do some pastory things in hopes that I would finally get it. So that day he said, "Let's go to the hospital." As we rode in the car together, he told me, "This will be a good experience for you. But I want you to know that we can't share anything about the patients with folks back at church unless we get the patient's permission, okay?" I agree, understanding the patient's rights to privacy. So we went to see a man whose name I've blocked out of my mind, and we'll see why soon. We got to the man's room, we walked in. He was probably about 75 and had just had surgery on his thigh. He talked about the surgery for a minute, and then he asked, "Want to see my incision?" Now, it's not the last time I've been asked that question without being given a chance to answer. Nor is it the last time a patient has eagerly shown me his surgical scar, but it is the last time I saw a 75-year-old man whip open his hospital gown to expose a lot more than just his incision. My pastor, who was very flustered, quickly helped the patient cover himself back up, and we said a quick prayer and left. As soon as we got into the hallway, I said, "And you mean to tell me I can't tell anybody about that?" That has to be what the disciples were thinking on that day coming down from the mountain, though for a very different reason. Having experienced something so unusual and powerful, how could they keep it to themselves? And why did they want them to? They had seen that Jesus was so much more than just a preacher who could heal people. Yet they had felt the glory of God. They had seen 2 of God's all-stars on the mountain who were outshone by their dazzlingly bright teacher, and they had heard the voice of God speaking not to Jesus but to them. Why would Jesus ask them to go along to experience something so amazing if they couldn't share it? Just for their own enrichment? They had to be replaying every second of that mountain experience in their heads to figure out exactly why they'd been asked to be there. Jesus had summoned them, they had climbed, they had seen Moses, Elijah, and Jesus shining white. Peter, who wasn't rendered quite speechless enough and was baffled about the etiquette for such an occasion, had blurted out an offer to build these 3 dwellings for the 3 men before them. But the voice of God quickly cut him off by telling him what he'd said at Jesus' baptism. "This is my son, the beloved. With him I am well pleased." And he added, "Listen to him." The disciples fell to the ground, and soon after God's echo had trailed off, they felt Jesus' hand on their shoulders again, saying, "Get up, don't be afraid." I'm certain that the disciples were honored and humbled to be there that day, but sometimes I wonder what Jesus' role was in inviting them. Obviously, their experience opened their eyes to the glory of God, and of Jesus. But you'd think there would be another reason, a message that was intended just for the three of them at that moment. I must say that I wondered a number of times why my pastor had asked me to go to the hospital that colorful day. And I can't tell you how many times I've wondered what would possess a man to bear a whole lot more than a soul to his pastor and a young woman who tagged along. On the way home from the hospital that day, Pastor and I talked about ministry. He said, "See, if you're worried that ministry will be boring, today's proof there's always surprises to keep things interesting." We started talking about what it felt like to be called to ministry. I'd been told many times that I should be a pastor, but I didn't feel that God had told me, at least not the voice from the cloud on the mountain. My pastor finally looked at me when we were stopped at a stoplight, and he said, "God speaks to us through other people. Listen to people, and you'll hear God." Peter, James, and John had followed Jesus for probably over 2 years by the time they saw Jesus transfigured. They probably knew that they felt called to follow Jesus, but I'm not sure they knew what that would mean, especially after Jesus was gone. I think Jesus chose these disciples to join him, obviously so they could see him in all his glory, but also so they could receive their own calling, their mission for the rest of their lives. God gave them their first set of directions in his word from the cloud. Listen to him. Listen to my son. His words will guide you. And the second set of directions came from Jesus himself. Get up. Don't be afraid. I don't think those words were just about them cowering on the ground that day. I think Jesus was calling them to ministry, calling them to get up, literally to rise and not be afraid of what's to come. They couldn't just stay on the mountain forever. They couldn't just stay disciples following Jesus forever. A day would come when they'd have to take everything they'd learned Jesus, listen to Jesus say, and they'd have to get up and be fearless in carrying out his mission without him. This experience on the mountain would be their strength and inspiration when they were weak and downtrodden. The mountain was not their destination. It was like a service station, a pit stop on their journey, where they were filled up and given what they needed to get going. But the question is, if God was calling these three disciples, what about the other nine? Why didn't they get to go up the mountain? I think the answer is that God calls people in different ways. God doesn't call everybody from on top of the mountain. I think God called the other disciples in different ways, telling them that they should get up and go, but always hearing Jesus in their ears. Even though the other disciples were just going about their everyday lives and the other three got to hear God's voice, it doesn't make them any less special or any less called. They were important to the church. They preached the good news of Jesus, they healed, they baptized, and many of them even wrote gospels. My adventure at that first hospital visit certainly wasn't a mountaintop experience, but that day showed me that I could handle the unexpected, and I started to hear God's voice calling me in the voices of others. I think sometimes we don't feel like we're called by God to do anything. We figure that the word calling is for special people like Moses and Peter and pastors and a few others. We may not feel like we are called. But we are. God calls us each in unique ways. Not all of us are called to be prophets or pastors, and thank goodness for that. Some of us are called to be teachers, nurses, parents, grandparents, caregivers, business people, musicians, listeners, artists, friends, prayers, and a million other things. Whatever your vocation is in your everyday life, you have the opportunity to meet and talk to people who people like me might never meet. So your calling is vitally important. Whether it's a vocation you're paid for or one that you do out of sheer joy, you have a calling to share God's grace in your words and your deeds. God may have called you on a mountain, in a valley, in a time of joy, in a time of hopelessness, God may have called you through the voice or example of another person, or by a certain passion or ability. No matter how we're called to serve God, God always calls us to listen to Jesus as our guide, to feel the Holy Spirit as our inspiration, to get up, to be fearless, to think, to reach outside ourselves to share Jesus through our lives. The man I visited in that hospital may actually have had something to teach me on this Transfiguration Sunday, and to teach us all. He wasn't shy. He wasn't afraid. He wanted to show me his incision, which he did without worrying what I would think. Maybe that is something to say to us about what we've got to share with the world in a more appropriate way, of course. Too often, we're so shy about God's call to us and about God's grace. We keep God's grace hidden, keeping it under wraps, afraid that if we share it, we'll all be left feeling naked and exposed. But we're not those three disciples who Jesus told to keep the secret hidden that day. We're called to whip open the truth of God's grace, because God's grace is something everyone needs to hear and experience, something we've all been called to expose. Try to forget that metaphor. Go share God's grace with the world. Amen.